spared from being put to death?
Because they heeded the destruction that was coming. Therefore, Yah was giving them the ability to say, look, if you want to spare your livestock and Pharaoh's livestock, take it in the house. Anything in the field will die. And that's what happened. Not very hard to understand. No problem.
Exodus 14, 23. So, if this goes to hermeneutic, that it was only the horses in the field, right? Exodus 14, 23, real quick. So, let me ask you a question. Were there any horses that got drowned in the Red Sea when Moses split the ocean?
Yes.
Those people who pursued the Israelites on horseback, were they...
They were Pharaoh servants in the military that worked for Pharaoh.
Right. So
some of those same people. Hold on, stop. Some of those same people that literally worked for Pharaoh feared Yah in Exodus 9 and 20.
I understand the hermeneutic. But my question was, if they feared HEZEKYHWH, that's like in the New Testament where the apostles, you know, was with Jesus and then later they abandoned him. So my question is, if these are servants, the horses that were spared, right, were servants, right? Correct?
Correct.
And why would they then come back later?
They didn't fear HEZEKYHWH. They feared the word of HEZEKYHWH.
So they feared the word of HEZEKYHWH. Why would they then later in the Exodus, then who fear the word of HEZEKYHWH, then chase HEZEKYHWH's people through the Red Sea? Makes no sense.
Because they feared Pharaoh more. They feared flesh more. Just like today.
Oh, chapter verse says the servants of Pharaoh.
Listen. I don't have to even show you that. You just said it yourself. If they're called servants of Pharaoh, they serve who?
Pharaoh.
Okay. But they feared, verse 20 says, they feared the word of the Lord, not Yah himself.
So if they feared the word of the Lord, why would they then chase the Lord's people on horseback?
Because the Lord didn't come back through Moshe and say, don't follow us. He didn't say that. Remember, this time Yah gave no warning because he said, I'm going to send
The verse that says that the servants horses that were spared feared. Reason why they chased the Israelites through the Red Sea is because they feared Pharaoh over HEZEKYHWH. Show me that.
They never feared Yah. They feared the word of Yah in verse 20, not Yah. Because remember, it's just the words that he spoke about.
That makes no sense. That's a fault.
It makes no sense to you because you're a mumbling Muslim. You're not listening.
No, it makes sense. That's invented.
Okay, listen like this. Stop. Let me do it like this here. The Israelites live by laws, correct? They had certain laws, fringes, the whole nine, right?
Hold on, follow my train of thought. I want to say one thing. So, on one hand, during the Exodus, they feared Pharaoh more. But when it comes to putting their livestock inside, at that point, they feared Yah more.
Are you listening? Are you intentionally not listening? I literally just told you they did not fear Yah. They feared the calamity, the word that Moshe was saying. You never get it if you're always mumbling. Mumbling Muslim.
Okay, go ahead.
This is not the first sign, correct?
Correct.
So you have plagues, correct?
Yes.
So if I tell you tomorrow, Lewis, that my God told me, my strong one, Elohim Yah, if I told you that Yah told me tomorrow that there will be hail the size of basketballs. Okay? And you gotta listen. That's plague one. He said, okay, man, it's springtime. And then tomorrow, it was literally hail the size of basketballs. You'd be like, hold on, maybe he saw a weather forecast or whatever, right? You just shut it off. Then I said, hey, I came back the next week and said, hey, Lewis, tomorrow, it's going to rain caterpillars. There's going to be tons of millions of caterpillars all up on the ground, on people's houses, cars, the whole nine. And you say, what? That's crazy. And then the next day, there's millions of caterpillars. Now you're going to look and say, hold on, is he getting this from a weather channel? Where's this coming from? Okay? So then I come back and say, hey, look, the water is going to turn to blood. Okay? you're like, oh, whatever. And then it turns to blood. After I keep saying these things, and I keep telling you it's not me saying them, that my strong one, in lack of a better word, my God is telling me, but my strong one, Yah, is saying this to me, eventually you'll start to what?
Believe it?
You'll start to believe it. It says they feared the word, not Yah himself. They didn't submit to Yah. They just feared the word of the calamity. Not all the words, just the words of that curse that was coming. Where the animals that stayed and the cattle that stayed out in the field would be destroyed. That's the only thing they feared. It didn't say they feared to hurt his anointed people. It didn't say they feared to put them in chains again and beat them and rape them and rob them. It didn't say that. It said they feared their cattle dying because they had been seeing these curses.
Bro, what are you talking about? You're making no sense. If I'm walking down a street on I'm chasing Israelites on horseback, uh-huh, and this nigga Moses takes a staff, excuse my language, and splits the Red Sea, I'm like, yo, what the hell's going on? The Red Sea just split open. So
you're thinking about the movie. It didn't happen like that. They went on the side of the hill saying, that's what the movie shows you. They went on the hill saying,
you're telling me if I'm pursuing you on horseback and you took a staff, Moses takes the staff, according to the biblical narrative, and splits the Red Sea in half. You go, uh-huh, oh, show, what the hell?
Just, when you go back up, when you go back up into chapter 9 and stop being a mumbling Muslim, and you actually look at what it says,
Let's go to verse 3 real quick.
What did it say up there? It said that Yah says, I'm going to do all of these things to show my what?
Okay.
No, he didn't say okay. He didn't say okay. What did he say?
He said glory, right?
Yes, to show his power.
Right.
Okay? To show his power.
Let me ask you a question. Was Pharaoh drowning the Red Sea?
Nowhere in the... Show me a chapter and verse that says Pharaoh was drowning the Red Sea.
Okay, you got the floor.
See, this is the problem. You guys watch too many movies. You're watching Disney movies. You're watching all this other stuff. You're doing everything except reading. Mumbling Muslims. You're watching Charleston Heston. Mumbling Muslims. Just read it. You don't have to watch a movie. Read it. See, and everything you look at as a, that's called predictive programming. So you learn this. You learn the story. Notice this. In all the movies, Moses never puts his hand in his bosom and come back out white and go back black. You know why? Because the white man can't replicate that actual sign. So you don't see that in the movies. That's why y'all don't ever really talk about it. So you're going off what you learned as a child from Sunday school and from the movies. And probably from the unglorious Quran. Okay? That's what you're doing. You're doing everything instead of reading the book that you're attacking. You're not reading it. That's a fool. You're attacking something you don't understand and you're not reading. Because you literally just said that all the cattle died, but if you read the rest of the verse, it showed you that some cattle were spared, the ones that were scared and put the cattle in the house. And guess what? All of Pharaoh's royal chariot pullers, royal horses, etc., would not be out in the field. They would be brought in a barn or something particular. Even today we see that, right?
Certainly.
But you just said it made no sense.
Correct. So
everybody listening to is going to get what I'm saying.
If the word of Yahweh, hey, but then later on, a couple chapters.
Mm-hmm. Saying it. Hold on, bro. Go up to verse 6. Go, do this here. Listen. Go up to verse. Go down to verse.
No, I got verse 3. I got Shemot 9 and 3. It says, behold.
I'm not saying 3. 9 and 3 doesn't say anything. Okay, look, man. This is getting very difficult because you're not reading. This is what I just said to you. I want you to do me a favor. Go down, right? I want you to go to verse 16. Read that for me.
Sure. This is Shemot, also known as Exodus. chapter 9, verse 16, and in very deed for this cause, as I raised thee up for to show in thee my power, and that my name may be declared throughout the earth. All the
so Pharaoh was rolled as the number one superpower, so Yah could show him that there's a power stronger than you. So this is all from Yah's hand. That's why Moshe is only saying what Yah is saying. It's not Moshe giving his own account. Now check this out.
So let me ask you a question.
Hold on for a second. Sure. Hold on for a second. Now, read verse 20 and explain verse 20 to me, because you keep saying something totally different.
Verse 20?
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Then I had a question after that. I'm going to read that first. It's Exodus Shimon chapter 9, verse 20. Here first the word of Yahweh amongst the servants of Pharaoh, made his servants and his cattle flee into the houses.
Now, they feared Yah or feared the words that Moses was speaking? Which one?
This is the word, his word there.
Yes, the word. So when he was saying, I'm going to destroy your cattle, they were afraid of that and put the cattle in the house. It didn't say they went in the house and started saying, we're going to keep the laws. So they didn't fear Yah. They feared the word that Moses was speaking about the devastation that was coming. They didn't start worshiping Yah. They didn't say that. It's the word that was given by Moshe about the coming hell destruction that they feared. But you keep saying they feared Yah. They did not fear Yah. They feared the destruction. I can't make this any simpler. It's like y'all fear hellfire. You don't fear Yah. Y'all fear Antichrist. All y'all that say garbage New Testament. You don't fear Yah. You fear everything but Yah.
Okay, let's go.
You fear the third world's war and all this other stuff. Everything except Yah. So now you should listen. If you understand it now, it don't matter,
because
everybody else will understand it.
Yeah, we go to 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 18.
Okay.
1 Chronicles 4 and 18, please.
Okay. Go ahead.
And it reads, this is 1 Chronicles 4 and 18, I had a question. It says, and his wife, Jedudah, bare Jared, the father of the door, and his brother, Yehudiah, bare Jared, the father of Gador, and her brother, father, 1 second.
Okay.
Excuse me. And Yukadel, the father of Zona, and these are the sons of Bathiah, the daughter of Pharaoh, which Mary took, right?
Uh-huh.
So Bathiah in Chronicles 4 was Pharaoh's daughter, correct?
Uh-huh.
An Egyptian Pharaoh, correct?
Okay.
Correct?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Why does she have Yahweh in her name? Or Yod-Heh-Waveh in her name? She's the daughter of Pharaoh. Explain that.
You said, why does she have what now?
It says, 1 Chronicles 4 and 18, and his wife, mm-hmm. Yedia, bear Yared, the father of Gador, and her brother, the father of Soko, and Yukathel, the father of Zona, and these are the sons of Bathiah, the daughter of Pharaoh, which Merit mm-hmm. took, right?
Correct.
So, hello?
Uh-huh.
Merit had a wife named Bathiah, right? Uh-huh. She was the Pharaoh's daughter, meaning she was an Egyptian Pharaoh's daughter. Correct. My question is, Bathiah actually translates, you know, Ben means son of Hebrew. Yeah, Bias is a female version of son, so it means daughter. Bathiah literally translates to daughter of Yah, or your church grammar time. So my question was, why does Pharaoh's daughter, a daughter of Pharaoh, have a Hebrew name?
Well, it's not that she has a Hebrew name. You got to remember that
why does she have Yod-Heh-Waveh in her name when she was the daughter of an Egyptian Pharaoh?
Okay, well, first off, you're trying to ask me something that's impossible to know. But let's just entertain this for a second. Nowhere in this chapter and verse does it say this is her Egyptian name. It doesn't say that. Correct? It tells you she's an Egyptian, but it doesn't say that that's her Egyptian name, that a Pharaoh.
No, she's not an Egyptian. She's not just an Egyptian. She's the daughter of Pharaoh. Not is she just
that's
Egyptian,
what I just that's what I just said. Lewis, listen, stop. I just said to you, nowhere in this verse does it say Pharaoh named her this. That's you're adding that to the text. Because you're trying to find fault. So what you're doing is you're adding things that's not written. And the reason I'm saying that is because there's multiple people in the Bible, in the Torah, the Tanakh, that have multiple names, true or false. Names are changed, true or false.
True, no, no problem. Sure, I'm asking
a black man. No, hold on, stop. Now, this woman, would she be living in Egypt or would she be living among the children of Israel with her husband?
Children of Israel.
Okay, so if prime example. Let's just look at it in American terms. I'm married, right? My wife has my name, correct?
Yes.
Yes, because that's my wife. She doesn't keep rocking her own name. So it's no different than here. If she lives amongst those people, she's going to be called something totally different.
What do you do with, like, Jay-Z, for example, the billionaire rapper Jay-Z, mm-hmm. an entrepreneur who married Beyonce and took on her last name?
What his name is? Sean Knowles now?
Yeah, but if he took Carter.
Do you know or do you believe? Because we're not talking
about... I'm 95% sure he took all
okay,
of
listen. There's nothing I have to do with that because we're talking about customs of the old world and even the majority. You're giving me a one-off of a...
We're not talking customs of the old world. We're talking about...
Okay, let me type in Jay-Z and see if his last name is Knowles. Because yeah, you just said that, but you didn't even give any proof that that's the truth. Correct?
Yeah. Is that safe to say? Yeah.
Okay. So let's look it up. Let's look it up real quick. Jay-Z as Beyonce's last name? ? It says Beyonce is no longer Beyonce Knowles Carter. The queen is dropping her husband's last name. MTO News has confirmed Beyonce changed her last name legally to Knowles Carter just a few months after she and Jay-Z got married, and she kept the name up until now. This was February 11, 2019. Sean Corey Carter. It doesn't say nothing about Sean Corey Knowles.
I'm looking at it right now. I'm on Reddit. It says Jay-Z legally changed. Hold on a second. What the hell? Sorry, guys. Jay-Z legally changed his real name to Sean Knowles Carter when he married Beyonce in order to contain the Knowles line since her parents didn't have any sons. So Jay-Z did take on his
own wife. He just explained it. Why are you asking me to explain something he doesn't explain? He says he's doing it because their parents had no daughters. That's weird as hell. Yeah, but that's why he said it.
He took on his wife's last name. But let's go forward.
No. He didn't take on her last name. It says Sean Knowles Carter. Carter is the last name. It's like a hyphenated name. You see a lot of African Americans do that for some reason they're widows. But you see, Sean knows Carter, and he said he did it because she, a family, mother and father, had no sons. So even here, you can see it's weird, but you can see in old, backed up ancient times where you're trying to continue a bloodline, even though that makes no sense because whatever baby he puts in her, that baby is going to be a Carter. That's common sense. But again, you're telling me about the rapper. You're trying to compare a rapper to Meryl Streep.
He's not just a rapper. He owns the New Jersey...
Lewis, how about this here? Let's just say he owns Twitter, Apple, Microsoft, and he owns Google, okay? Let's just say he owns all of those. It doesn't matter.
Excuse me, he owns the Brooklyn Nets.
Listen, son. It doesn't matter. Nowhere in that verse that you just read does it say anything about the daughter of Pharaoh rocking her last name. She doesn't even have a last name. So
let's go back on top.
Because you always go back on top.
Why does Bethiah, the daughter of Pharaoh, have a Semitic name? That's the question.
Because she lived amongst those Semitic people.
Chapter and verse, it says she took on the name of the people.
That's what I said from the beginning. I told you from the beginning, there's nothing in that verse that you're trying to insinuate that Pharaoh named her that. That's what I said from the beginning. Now you're telling me chapter and verse. That's what I'm telling you. It's not there. So there's no.
Why doesn't it tell us if she took on a Semitic name because she married Mary, who was an Israelite?
Huh? Because she married Mary.
Was Mary an Israelite?
Was who?
Her husband married. But that was Mary. Was Mary.
Yeah. Well, that's what you just read, didn't you? That's what you read, didn't
you? No, I'm asking you. All your knowledge and wisdom. Was he an Israelite?
Yeah, it says he's an Israelite.
Oh, he was an Israelite. Okay.
Yeah, so, Hebrew 4:7-8.
Okay.
It's all in the Torah. Twice.
What tribe was he from, Mary?
It doesn't say. I don't know what tribe he's from. You have to probably go back up and read the context of the book. It doesn't matter. But if you look up 4778 in Hebrew, in the Strong's, it says married an Israelite.
Okay, so
you're asking questions about something you should already know.
Sure. So you couldn't answer, for the record, people listening, he couldn't explain why Bathiah, who's the daughter of Pharaoh, Egyptian Pharaoh,
lived amongst the Israelites. And we see examples of this behavior of people living amongst the Israelites, just like we see Israelites living amongst Babylonians having their names changed. Daniel's name, he was called Belteshazzar, correct?
What do you do with, like, Pharaoh Necho, for example, who put Jehoiakim on the throne of David and lived him, I mean, but anyway, okay, so you're saying
he put him on the throne, but he didn't live amongst the Egyptians. He put him on the throne in Israel.
Yeah, okay. What you're saying is she became she took on the name of Yoni Wafe because
No, I'm not saying anything. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying to you is you're trying to insinuate that her daddy named her that, and it doesn't say that in that verse.
Correct, but it also doesn't say that she name was changed when she
But we have instances of people living amongst the Israelites and partaking and being called as one of that tribe. That's the law of the stranger. And she would be a stranger in this case. She's not an Israelite. She lives amongst the Israelites. She marries an Israelite. And guess what? If she's living amongst the Israelites and they're righteous at that time, she has to follow the law of the Israelites. She's a daughter of Yahweh.
Let me ask you a question. When Merit lived, what century is this?
Bro, listen. What is it? What does it got to do with the Exodus? I just answered the question.
Yeah, the reason why I asked what century this was, because if Egypt was a superpower this time, and Israel was not, why the hell would she abandon her Egyptian identity to be a member of some nomadic Semites who...
No, 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 they're not nomadic in the Book of Chronicles, dum-dum. They have a land in the Book of Chronicles.
Yeah, I agree. That's what I'm asking you.
You don't agree. You just call them nomadic.
Yes, because that's why I asked the question, what century was it? That's why I asked that.
Louis, we're talking about the Book of Chronicles. You don't have Chronicles without Kings. Kings and Chronicles is the same timeline. So we're talking about from the 10th century BCE all the way down. We're talking about 400 years after the Exodus.
Hold on. Who wrote Chronicles?
There's no writer of Chronicles. It's everybody. It's the Chronicle history. It's like asking who wrote American history. Everybody does, because it happens every day. There's no person that writes all the history. How are you going to live long enough? You're asking crazy. That's like asking me, who wrote down the Hadith? It's obvious the Hadith wasn't written by one person. Because it's over vast periods of time, correct? Because Muhammad wasn't alive. So it's the same principle. You've been a slave so long, you didn't understand how a civilization works. You're literally sitting here thinking that a person writes the history for the entire nation. That's how crazy y'all are. Mumbling Muslims.
I'm not totally in the
context. Okay, let's do it like I said. My father is deceased, right?
Yeah.
My father is deceased. My father wrote down some history, but he's deceased now. So who would write down the history? Who would take the photos and update the family tree since he's dead now? Him or me? He's dead.
Well, that'll be you.
Oh, so is it safe to say that says history happens every day, that no one person can write history?
I never said what it was one monolithic
author. No, you said who wrote the Book of Chronicles. And I'm telling you, it's the history of the nation of Israel.
Okay, so let it ask me what tribes contributed to the Book of Chronicles.
What do you mean? It doesn't matter. That's like who wrote American history. You can't name 50 scribes. You can't. You have to Google and buy a book.
That's interesting. You adapt that hermeneutic when you're not messianic, correct?
Correct.
But then you question the authenticity of the Gospels, but then you don't know who wrote Chronicles. Isn't that kind of like...
No, I don't question the authenticity of the Gospels. The Gospels are being claimed to be written by a single person named Matthew or Mark or Luke or John, and then history shows they didn't write them. But the Chronicles is not saying a man named Chronicle 1 and a man named Chronicle 2 and a man named King 1 and a man named King 2 wrote them. It's not saying that. It's saying this is the entire history from this point to this point of the children of Israel. That's what it's saying. It is not saying a man named Chronicle One wrote all the Chronicles. Matter of fact, when you look right here in First Chronicles that we're reading right here, it's telling you about bloodlines being born, correct?
Hello?
Is that correct?
Yeah, certainly.
Okay, so, Lewis, okay, look. It says descendants of Yahuda. That's what it says in 1 Chronicles chapter 1. The sons of Yahuda. Now, when Yahuda is here, when you go down all the way to verse 22, Yahuda is not alive at that time. So every family has to keep their family tree. I don't know about you, but we had this book. And in this book, it showed who my grandmama was, my great-grandmama was, my granddaddy was, my great-granddaddy was. It couldn't go back as far because of slavery, of course, obviously. But even right now, I add myself, I add my sons, Hezekiah and Noah, to that book. My wife is in that book, who I married. My brothers are in that book, who they married, and their children. That's called a family tree. My daddy could not have written that because he was dead when my sons was born. So when you look at the book of Chronicles, the word chronicle means a narrative that's been written down about history. That's what chronicle means. So no one man can write all the history unless he has somebody that already wrote it and he's just rewriting it. That's the only way you can do it. Like if you got a history book or you find the book and then you buy a new one and write it over that your forefathers already wrote in. Sometimes people didn't have a book. They used the Bible. In the Bible, to show a family tree. You know, the old school Bible have family tree. Well, you might don't know about that. You're Mumble Muslim. So it'll have a family tree in it. You'll write down with your mother, grandmother, all these people, and cousins, all this, and you'll see a big tree. Same thing here. That's all you're reading here. We're doing the same things that our fathers did. We're doing the same things. Verse 1, literally says that this is about Judah's descendants. When you get down to the last verse, it's not about Judah's descendants because Judah is no, I mean, it's not about Judah couldn't have written it because Judah's been dead. And the reason we know that is because when you go to verse 23, it starts talking about Sarah, who had the dominion in Moab. Judah never went to Moab. Judah died, Lewis. Judah died in Egypt. Judah the man died in Egypt, correct?
Yes, sir.
Correct. Okay, so how in the hell are you asking me who wrote it? It's the families writing it. The priests, the family. We see that in Nehemiah. When it says that they didn't find themselves amongst their genealogy, amongst the letters. Everybody it's your job to keep up with your family. Even America sends a census out. How are you asking me? And I don't know the person that sent you the mail to your census. I don't know who that person is. You don't even know who they are. They just work, they got a job. You fill it out or you don't, or whatever case may be. You send it back in. You don't know who the hell sent you that letter.
Who wrote Chronicles, though?
What do you mean? It's the history of our people. It's not one man, but you keep insinuating it's one man because you're unlearned. Now, when you go to verse 24, it says the sons of Simeon. Well, we know Simeon didn't write it because Simeon can't write about his great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren because they were in the wilderness and Simeon never made it to the wilderness. He died in Egypt. He died in Egypt.
Let me respond to that. Is that not the case? Doesn't Genesis chapter 49 believe the patriarch Jacob is articulating what would happen to his sons in the last days? Is that correct?
Yes. No. His sons in the last days, the tribes. It's not talking. Lewis, how the hell is Judah still alive today? I know you didn't say that idiotic. He's saying what would happen to his sons in the last days.
Yeah, didn't he predict what was going to happen? Like, for example, it says that...
Yes, you can predict, but he didn't... Oh, my goodness. You know what, bro? That's called prophecy.
For example, I believe, for the people, I believe that there's something called the 12 tribes chart, which is
I don't deal with belief. That's, if you believe that, that has nothing to do with the Exodus, so I'm not dealing with that.
Yeah, okay, sure.
So again, when you go to Genesis 49, Bereshit 49 is a prophecy about what is going to happen to his children in the last day. Not Judah. It's the tribe of Judah or Yahuda. Okay? Yahosef, Joseph, Ephraim, and Manasseh. It's the tribes. what's going to happen to their descendants, which shall come upon them in the last day. Gad, a troop shall